Namaste and welcome to Urban Chatterati. This is Abhinav Prakash. And today I'm joined by Sain Deepak once again to discuss the recent politics around the Mopla genocide of Hindus and what is happening in Afghanistan and how over the past 100 years, nothing has changed when it comes to the whitewashing of the crimes of Islamism. So Sain Deepak, welcome to the show.
Namaste. Thank you, Abhinav. It's a pleasure to be with you.
Thank you, Sain. Sain, when we talk about the Mopla genocide of the Hindus, we are seeing that the left-wing government in Kerala, the Congress party, all the secular parties in India are celebrating. It is a great uprising against the British rule in India, a great uprising against oppression. Right. Whereas it was nothing but the part of the pan-Islamist Khilafat movement, which resulted in one of the worst massacre of Hindus in the history, in the modern history of India. So how do you look at the entire episode?
So I think it's very, very consistent, and it's a done to death strategy of the left, which they have been doing with every possible massacre of Hindus by people professing a certain religion. I think they tried to employ a similar strategy for Kashmir for the longest of periods. And unfortunately for them, I think in late 90s and 2000s, and particularly with the boom of the internet, that particular myth was busted. And for the very first time, I think their bluff has been called out at such a large scale on this particular subject, because the kind of backlash that they've received and the kind of response that they received in the form of, let's say, talks, shows, programs, articles, whatnot, podcasts, I think for the first time, they're beginning to realize that the tide has changed, or it has at least begun to change. And people are beginning to see what has been brushed aside typically as Hindutva propaganda or RSS propaganda or whatever it may be. And finally, they're also able to connect the dots either with respect to what has happened in Bengal from May and the similar mindset taking over in Afghanistan. I think history has presented perhaps the most opportune Overton window, according to me, for the rise of the Hindu psyche in this particular subject, and for them to actually remove the cobwebs of nonsense that they've been buried under for generations now, at least for the last 5-6 generations. So I believe that notwithstanding the attempts at whitewashing this genocide, for the very first time, there's a very clear response, and that is what I would draw heart from, because their strategy of trying to whitewash is something that is to be expected, that's stereotypical. What I'm more interested in are the multiple layers and the multiple strands of arguments that people are coming out with, and the growing sense of history that I clearly see as far as Hindus are concerned. And the reason why they must actually pay attention to history is reinforced by the other side more than our own preaching and pontificating. So I think the other side is doing a fantastic job of awakening Hindus. I wish more power to them, and I hope they continue to whitewash and give us an opportunity to respond.
Yes, but could you throw some light on the Mopla genocide as well, because lots of people are really confused whether it was some kind of peasant uprising who were killing Hindu landlords in the region because Hindu landlords were siding with the British. So that's a standard Marxist left-wing argument. So what happened exactly in 1921?
My limited reading and understanding of this, based on what Sandeep Balakrishna has written, based on what Dr. Ambedkar has written, and based on what Annie Besant has written, this much is very clear, that the southern part of Malabar is actually that particular region which has the remnants of what they call the Tipu Sultan's army. Okay, that's the place where maximum amount of conversions took place. If you ask any Malayali, if you ask them what that particular period is referred to as, there is a word that they use, which is Padayattam, which effectively means the march of Tipu. Okay, roughly that's what it translates to, or the ravage of Tipu. Okay, so Padayattam, I think, translates to march, Padayatra. So it's Padayatra becomes a Padayattam. Okay. And how, let's say, the Nayars were killed in thousands of numbers and forts and all of that. I think that's a memory that's seared in their heads very, very deeply in their consciousness. And the beef consumption that they were subjected to during that period is also very, very clear. Okay. So that explains the skewed demography of that particular region. Okay. Otherwise, Malabar is typically the land of Parshuram. Okay, which has several temples. What we have given up today as a space that's completely gone as a mini Pakistan, which is Malappuram, is otherwise a place which has a lot of temples. And something that I would like to inform your viewers is that there is a grassroots movement that is going on in that particular part of the country, where a lot of Hindus are taking back temples and reviving temples and beginning to use temples as temples. Okay, so that's the history of this place. So it comes as no surprise, or it shouldn't have come as any surprise, that this particular region was heavily invested in the Khilafat movement, or let's say the dismantling of the Ottoman Caliphate as part of the First World War. So here's the juxtaposition. When Saddam was being attacked by, let's say, by the United States, I think one of the most vocal oppositions to the United States came from Malappuram, again, from this particular part of the country. And you'll find a lot of streets named after Saddam Hussein there. Okay. You'll find a lot of streets named after places in Iraq. Okay. Streets, cities, and what, let's say towns and whatnot, you'll continue to find them. So this is not something that's new. It has always been there. Okay. So when the Khilafat movement starts, clearly they are looking at joining forces with, or at least establishing solidarity with, the global movement of the Ummah. And they see this again as some kind of a Western attempt at dismantling a legitimate caliphate and an attack against Islam. To a significant extent, quite a few people have seen that as an extension of the crusade, notwithstanding the fact that you had the Axis powers fighting along with the Ottoman caliphate. Okay, so it's a very skewed way of looking at it, but nevertheless, that was the way they looked at it. And of course, you know the history of the Ali brothers, who decided to participate, or at least gave their word to the great Mahatma for his cooperation as far as his movement is concerned, the non-cooperation movement. And ultimately, I think he delivered better on his promise of supporting the Khilafat movement than them actually supporting the non-cooperation movement. That's something that has happened. But here's where it gets very, very interesting, that Marxism and its comfortable partnership or alliance with Islamism couldn't have found a better textbook example than the so-called peasant rebellion of the Mokhlas. Okay, because you see the language and the framework of Marxism being employed to justify what is clearly and evidently an Islamist genocide of Hindus. Okay. Now, when in the discussion with, or in the debate with Mr. Tharoor, he just pointed out that, but no, there were quite a few Hindus who participated in this particular rebellion. There are quite a few people who actually gave shelter to the persecuted Hindus. And therefore, there are multiple theories, and therefore, we must not jump to these kind of abrupt or summary conclusions, was his argument. Again, I think he makes the point which only proves my entire premise, that there's a distinction between identity and consciousness. That Marxist Hindus were Hindus in name only, and they fundamentally saw a greater sense of solidarity and alliance with Islamists than their own co-religionists. Okay, therefore, according to me, the fact that they had Hindu names or were otherwise Hindu sounding doesn't change the fact that they were first Marxist and certainly not Hindu, not even second Hindu. Okay, so considering that, this particular logic that they keep using is a convenient way of weaponizing identity as opposed to focusing on the consciousness, which is to say, notwithstanding the fact that you may have a Hindu identity, do you behave like a Hindu? Do you consider this yourself as part of this particular community? Do you stand for your community's rights? The fact is that no one who is a Marxist can ever profess to be a complete Hindu. There are very few exceptions, very few honorable exceptions. Okay, so considering that, this is a textbook instance where people must read over and over again the role of Marxism in providing the justifications, the intellectual justifications, and the hypocritical justifications for Islamism. This has happened all along, whether it's in history or elsewhere. So they start creating this particular justification, and this movement effectively sees Hindus as collaborators along with the colonial masters, and they see both of them as usurpers of what they see are Muslim lands. Okay, so if they see this as Muslim land, and they believe that the former colonizer, or the one who has been defeated, is now in cahoots with the current ruler, which is the British master, both of them are a common enemy. Okay, so a rough equivalent, a very crude equivalent, is the way the Islamists in Kashmir see the alliance between, or the perceived alliance between, the Indian Army and Kashmiri Hindus. Okay, which I think this director Bhardwaj comes out very clearly in his movie Heather, and that's effectively how he was projecting this entire thing, where he says he sees Hindus as informers of India, and the Indian Army as a colonizing entity, which is there only to protect Hindus to the detriment of Muslims. So that is more or less the psyche that even informs the entire genocide of Hindus in Malabar. Now, what is important to note is that notwithstanding the fact that certain Muslims may have actually sheltered Hindus, which is contestable, all the leading leaders and thought leaders and the men on the street of this so-called movement or the so-called rebellion were very clear about their solidarity in the name of Islam and their solidarity with the establishment or the re-establishment of an Islamic caliphate. That, according to me, takes away any semblance or smidgen of any secular character of this particular massacre. This was not a movement. This was not a rebellion by any stretch of imagination. The fact that the people who were landlords happened to be Hindus is just a happy coincidence. Their landlordship is merely a happy coincidence. But the primary aspect of their identity, which was the focus of this entire action, was the Hindu identity and not the fact that they were landlords. The Hindu landlord is the problem, not the fact that he was just a landlord, because the lands were taken over and these were supposedly Muslim lands. Now, the accounts are very, very clear of the number of naked parades, the number of gang rapes, the number of pregnant women killed, the number of people who were decapitated, the number, the mass change in demography of that entire region. What you see today in terms of the population distribution in North Kerala and Malappuram and all of that is significantly as a consequence of this particular genocide. But most importantly, this is perhaps one of those few genocides which have happened in Kerala, which were decently covered and well reported through first-hand accounts and eyewitness accounts. Otherwise, I recently read that between 1838 and 1921, at the very least, you had half a century such incidents. That is at least 50 such incidents, okay, of comparable scale or at the very least of smaller scale.
In okay? Kerala.
In Kerala, after 1838. Okay, so the Hindus of Malabar weren't witnessing this for the very first time. But the savagery and the kind of atrocities that were meted out and committed as part of this particular genocide is the reason why it was captured so well. And you have to understand, between 1838 and 1921, the British establishment was still in the process of establishing itself in certain parts of the country in terms of the administrative structure. Okay, it's only after 1857 that the crown takes over and then there's a proper system. Until then, it's the company running the place like a bunch of mercantile people. Okay, now therefore, this effectively translates to what? Greater presence of gazetteers, greater presence of historians, greater presence of administrators who are in a position to record every atrocity. That's precisely why this particular atrocity was covered so beautifully in 1921. Okay, so there's a decent chance that something of this nature or at least comparable scale would have happened before 1921, okay, but may not have received the same kind of coverage simply because the infrastructure was lacking. Okay, so according to me, this whitewashing is a textbook instance of the template that has been applied across the country. And most importantly, as I said this even before, this has been applied to Kashmir and this has now been even applied to pillaging of Somnath of 17 times because I've heard. So here's the funny part. There's this guy who is known as Lal Topi in Pakistan, this guy who keeps making fun of himself. So,
Hamid, some Zaid Hamid.
Yeah. So this guy, you should listen to him speak about the Islamic invasion of India. And he adopts the very same Marxist template saying that the Hindus, the Dalits, the Adivasis and the women were being trampled over by the Brahmins of Gujarat, of that part of Gujarat at that particular point of time. And the Muslim was the one to actually come and liberate all these people. And that is why, apart from the incidental obligation of having to destroy temples, which is Budparast logon ko to kisi bhi halat mein humiliate to karna hi hai, but beyond that, he liberated apparently the Hindus of the place. And therefore, Islam ki roshni translated to liberation of the Dalits, the Muslims, let's say the Adivasis, all these invented identities, he suddenly retrofits back to that particular era. He's talking of Dalits and all of these people when? In the 7th century, 8th century, 10th century, that's what he was talking about. So effectively, this whitewashing resonates and is in perfect sync with Pakistani's view of Bharat and Bharat's history. So, as I said, it's a state of mind. It is not limited by geography. So whoever does this, according to me, is aiding the Pakistani mindset.
No, that's very true. I see no difference between the left-wing opinion, the Islamist opinion. Not at all. I mean, they are one and the same. Effectively, as I think Sitaram Goyal effectively called out, that in India, the Islamic imperialism, the Western imperialism, and the Marxist imperialism have become one and the same. There is no difference between the three, even though they fight like blood enemies outside the boundaries of India.
Right.
But you raised a very important point. This repeated genocide and ethnic cleansing of the Hindus over the last 100, 150 years. And I think it got worse when the British disarmed the Hindus, you know, when the British brought in this entire rules and regulations, disallowing people to carry arms. And you see, there's a perfect coincidence with the massacre of Hindus which start all across the Indian subcontinent, even extending up to Afghanistan and even Xinjiang. People don't know that the Xinjiang Uyghur Muslims massacred the Hindus who were settled there for business and trade purposes. It was a very massive massacre of the Hindus. So how do you see this thing, that there's a complete denial? When you talk about these things, they will come, oh, why do you want to care about what Ghazni did? Are we going to live in the past, what Mughals did? No, we're talking about the modern history. We're talking about last 100, 150 years, something which is continuing even today.
Correct. See, one, assuming that this were a mere archival study of something that has happened in the past, which has no bearing on the present, I would still say it has a lot of value simply because it's important to understand the journey in its entirety. However, what makes it super relevant and contemporary is that the mindset continues to exist, and it continues to show itself in multiple places across the country. So there are multiple enclaves within Bharat, forget what happens outside Bharat, within Bharat, which are fostering and fermenting this mentality, taking us to, according to me, a stage is gradually being set for balkanization of Bharat. This is something that I think all of us are very clear about, that this is what is gradually happening. It's a question of, like beggars, they divide territories. Ye street tumhara, ye street mera. So therefore, regions and geographies of this particular country are divided between both kinds of mindsets. One is the proselytizing mindset and the other is an occupational mindset, let's say the occupying mindset or the expansionist mindset. That has been happening. Now, the banning of martial traditions, okay, the banning of several forms of martial arts in Kerala and other parts of the country, the banning of weapons is something that they did. Now, which tells us what? One, I think it's important to bust the myth that we are somehow some pacifist country which constantly follows the ideals of the newer version of Buddha and the current day modern Buddha being Mahatma Gandhi, okay, the apostle of peace and all that. I'm sorry to say we may be a peace-loving country, but we are not a pacifist society. Okay, there's a distinction between the two. Okay, and therefore, the deprival or the deprivation of martial traditions and the right to bear arms, which is perhaps even much more, it's older than the American tradition of bearing arms. Okay, this is something that has been happening for generations together. Several communities have believed in it. And this, according to me, is the single biggest reason that it has cultivated this myth that Hindus are cowards, Hindus are fundamentally defeatists, and they have not been able to resist any invasion. I had this question recently, that from Alexander onwards, how is it that this has happened? Most people don't even know that the community that is constantly accused of cowardice, which is the Brahmin community, was among the most vociferous opponents of Alexander in the Bactrian region. Along with their women and everything, they fought them with utensils and everything that that came their way. So this tells me that the martial spirit is not the exclusive preserve of any particular group, just as a knowledge tradition is not the exclusive preserve of any particular group. Okay, so that I think is extremely important. Two, we are being told, but if you seek to revive that particular tradition, will we not have law and order issues? Well, I go back to the standard American argument. The crook always has access to weapons, and therefore the law-abiding citizen also needs to have access to weapons, simply because you cannot, under any circumstances, guarantee the safety of people. Your security forces, or for that matter, your standard police force, is vastly outnumbered by the number of people as well as the number of criminals. So I'll give you a simple example. I recently was in Telangana. I had an opportunity to interact with senior police officials there as part of my security arrangements because I had to go there. 70,000 is the number of policemen in Telangana. After the bifurcation of undivided Andhra Pradesh, it is a decently sized state, but with a vast population. Hyderabad itself has such a huge population, and then you have the rest of the district. What is 70,000 as a number? What is this ratio? How does this even function? What can happen? forget the infrastructure that they have, forget the access to resources that, that they have, forget the training that they have. But in terms of sheer population comparison, at the very least, are you looking at 1:100 or 1:150? You're looking at 1:250 to 300. How on earth is one person supposed to do all of this? From digital crimes to standard crimes to everything under the sun. And even for that matter, not every bomb blast is necessarily handed over to any specialist agency. It starts with the police and then it goes, it's escalated subsequently. How much are they expected to do and how will they do? So the revival of a martial tradition and the decentralization of the use of force, not violence, is something that we have to seriously consider. Arms Act must be revisited. At the very least, I'm not looking at, firearms, but other kinds of arms, which are something that have been traditionally kept in houses, has to be kept. Because you see, then the only option left is to have a sickle and saying that you're a farmer. Okay. But you know this in our living memory, in 2012, in the Kokrajhar riots, okay, those people who are loyal to this particular country and who continue to, hold on to the indigenous faith systems of this country, were the ones to be massacred with AK-47s and whatnot. And their first request was, your security forces don't seem to reach in time. State is not able to help us in time. At least give us the bloody weapons. We'll take care of ourselves. Now, here's the simple question. If, let's say, certain communities in West Bengal had access to weapons, I don't think it would have been possible to commit this kind of a mass massacre of thousands of people, gang rapes and whatnot. These are realities. The fact is that the Indian state continues to be a soft state with respect to those communities which swear allegiance to the flag, which swear allegiance to the civilization. And therefore, from that perspective, I think a real discussion surrounding the Arms Act is extremely important, because with the changing demography and the demographic inversion being a reality in several parts of the country, we are looking at a serious law and order problem. And to assume that this particular demographic inversion results in violence only with respect to one particular community is wrong. Andhra Pradesh is a staring example, simply because quite a few temple-related events have been stalled by communities which are not Muslim, and church groups are actually supporting them. You've had incidents where the rathas of temples have been burnt just before important events. Okay, just Google for this event called the Antarvedi event. Okay, it's Antarvedi is an episode that happened in Andhra Pradesh this year, early this year, when the chariot of the temple was actually burnt. Okay. Cross plantation is happening across Andhra Pradesh. Takeover of lands, encroachment is happening, and small churches are mushrooming all over the Tirumala Hills. Okay, all of this is happening. So at some stage, you anticipate this. I'm sure the best person to actually shed much better light on this is Aravindha Neelakantan, because he'll tell you what happens in Kanyakumari and southern parts of Tamil Nadu. That's, and there it's not a question of soft proselytization. There's a clear use of force. There's a very clear use of force. And most people don't even want to talk about the fact that Naxals, in quite a few instances, happen to act as the sword arm of evangelical groups.
Yeah.
That is the reality. It's happened in Odisha and other parts of the country.
It's just no coincidence that the missionary belt and the Naxal belts coincide.
Coincide. Correct.
And the tribal belt coincide. It's no coincidence. Correct. I fully agree with your point, Sai. And when it comes to Indian state, it's not the question of soft and hard state. It has essentially been a ghost state for the 70 years. We just don't have numbers, as you just have told us. You know, we don't have police, we don't have doctors, we don't have teachers. We need a massive expansion of the state. And this is why I disagree with the libertarian argument of, you know, cutting down the size of the state and what. We don't have the size to begin with, right?
Like, correct.
America has 5 times more public employees than India, population-wise, per thousand, number-wise. But my last point, Sai, is about the, we have just seen the complete annihilation and the end of Hindu presence in Afghanistan, which did not happen even during the time of Ghori and Ghazni.
Correct.
There's a direct line what happened 100 years back in 1921 to what is happening in 2021. Complete annihilation, wipe out of the Hindu presence in an area which was once ruled by Hindu Shahi rulers. And it raises no outcry. Instead, we have a bigoted anti-Hindu conference organized by the American academia.
Correct.
I mean, what's happening? I mean, there's a clear attempt to celebrate the annihilation of Hindus, it seems, by the left wing and the liberal academicians in Western academia, at least. As of course, supported by lots of Indians.
Correct. So there are two streams of response, and I'll try to keep it as short as possible. I think the two persecuted communities in world history which have managed to produce self-loathing weaponized individuals from within themselves are the Hindus and Jews. Okay. Among the most vociferous opponents of the existence of Israel, are left-wing Jews within Israel as well as in America. Okay. And they populate American academia. Okay. And these are the people who actually actively mainstream wokeism. Okay. And I wouldn't be surprised if Hindus and Jews, the let's say the non-practicing left-wing variety, are the ones at the forefront of woke stupidity in America. I wouldn't be surprised even one bit. Okay. That's something that is the unfortunate reality of both communities. For some reason, despite being slapped around for thousands of years, them much longer than us. Okay. At the very least, we've had a country, we've had a home, we've fought, we've retained all of that. That's been a nomadic community for close to 2000 years since the Roman invasions. And still they somehow think of the Stockholm syndrome has been significantly internalized by vast sections of the Jewish community. That's an unfortunate reality. So while sometimes we look at Israel and say, Baba, kya kar diya, ye kar diya, this is also the reality that we have to face. Okay. So much so that if you go to Israel, they'll tell you that female members of the IDF are now vulnerable to love jihad. Okay. And they are turning. That's something that's happening. Okay. Now, second, coming to the point that you just made, it takes me to a slightly different argument. Let's have a rethink on the CAA, not just on, let's say, extending the cutoff dates and something else. See, one of the things that we have to consider is obviously having an Indian magic carpet policy, which is to say, let's get them all here, is the most sane policy, simply because they are outnumbered vastly. And to assume that only the state apparatus in these countries persecutes them is stupidity. It's the societal apparatus that persecutes them first, which is actively supported and endorsed by the state and defended by the state. That's how it works, right? Now, then what happens? As a country, you have a certain obligation, and as a civilization, you have another obligation. As a country, your obligation towards these Indic communities is bachao unko kisi bhi halat mein unko yahan pe leke aao. As a civilization, your obligation is to protect and preserve that space apart from protecting the people. Okay. Which means if India had greater clout and if India had, let's say, greater strategic influence, it should keep them there and protect them and tighten the screws on the regime and think of retaliatory measures if Indic communities and minorities are hurt. That way you retain your space and connection to that particular place. The obviously the easier alternative is unko sabko wahan se leke aata, but the consequence is the Hindu connection is gone and it cannot be revived in the foreseeable future. And even if there is a repatriation of Afghan Muslims from Bharat back to Afghanistan, I don't think the Hindus would want to go back, or they'd be welcomed with the same kind of let's say warmth. Okay. With all this, I think Bharat seriously needs to start thinking of a greater Bharat by way of a strategic influence in the long run. If that does not happen, the space will shrink even further. Okay. The hope that the support to the Balochis will result in better safety for Hindus, I'm sorry, that's a mirage. I haven't seen that happen yet. Suddenly there are calls of peace and Hindu Balochi brotherhood that are very convenient. That's happening on Twitter and other places. But is that how you treated Hindus when you were the princely state of Kalat? That's a question I'd like to ask. Did you participate in the riots? Did you kill Hindus? Did you destroy temples? Now, suddenly, since you're at the receiving end of the same barbarity that you meted out to Hindu communities, you're singing a different tune. Okay. So we need to be very, very clear about this. I don't want to be swept by any mushy notions of Vasudeva Kutumbakam at this stage. Uska time aayega, uska time abhi nahi hai. Okay. So the fact that 1921 and 2021, in such a short span of time, we've lost another space, and there's a whitewashing that's happening of the genocide that has happened in this country, tells me that we are closer to the worsening of the situation as opposed to it improving. Okay. Because despite partition, today there's a greater normalization and acceptance of Taliban 2.0 within this country, with several student organizations actually successfully celebrating the takeover of Afghanistan by Taliban from within India. Close to 8,000 to 10,000 students, and you look at social media and other places, these guys celebrate it. Okay. So I'm not sure we're actually in a better situation. Perhaps I think this is the best possible window to reawaken the dharmic psyche and tell them, remember the valor of your ancestors, and whatever shackles bind you, try to break free of them in the interest of civilizational existence and protection. I leave it at that.
Exactly. I fully agree to that, Sai. And I keep saying, when people say 1,000 years of slavery or 700 years of slavery, I say, no, it was 1,000 years of resistance.
Correct.
So on that note, Sai, let's end this discussion for today. Maybe we will meet again to discuss something other from this thing, maybe some for more hopeful and cheerful.
Right.
But thanks a lot for your time, Sai.
Thank you. Thank you. Namaste.
And thank you, audience, for listening to us. Please don't forget to subscribe to the channel and join to support the channel. Hoping to see you soon. Thank you.